Hello everyone, and welcome back to the D20 game. We've got Blastoed playing Jake Long, who has psychologically damaged people, killed dogs, God knows what else. And we have 50-foot Ant playing Savrok, who chops off corpses' hands, threatens to kill people, and has done untold damage to several people's psyche. We come back to them having just come back from the secret base. They've discovered a hidden room behind the armory that contains some planet cracker bombs. And they've also discovered that even if they attempt to turn off communication with the crystalline computer that they found at the secret base, the crystalline computer has some way of overriding the turn off functions on their suits for their radios. So, I have been dreading this because I have been receiving small bits of information that my players are planning something behind my back, which all DMs dread. So, shall we see where the players are going? So you've just left the hidden armory.
Mm-hmm. Had a discussion you guys with the computer. Had to convince her that we weren't intentionally killing her drones, but they were hostile. Got lenience on that matter, so great.
And you are currently running with masks closed because of the low oxygen on the station, that's right?
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Right.
So, what would you guys like to do next?
Follow the hallway, why not?
Follow the hallway.
Continue on with that.
Okay. Follow the hallway.
This map.
All right, while we're walking, this is out of character here. Are we going to follow through with the whole turning it into our own sort of prison planet, or are we just gonna, was that just us bullshitting?
I have no idea at this point, but I'm gonna run to the airlock and replenish my suit oxygen.
I'll follow you, because that is actually the smartest idea you've had all day.
That's a smart idea.
All week. Since we played last, that's the smartest idea.
So, in the buggy airlock, you find the usual suit connection units. Your suits have the universal connector, so you refill your onboard oxygen packs.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Alright. I want to, because I remember these doors were closed.
Yeah, are these doors open now?
Still closed, or what's the situation?
Those doors are open.
Okay.
If you look inside, you find that what used to be a green and lush hydroponics bay is now filled with a large amount of burnt and destroyed matter. The hydroponics units have been completely destroyed and set on fire. Obviously, someone's turned off the fire suppression within the hydroponics bay because they have literally burnt the hydroponics bay from end to end.
That was my plan.
Okay.
I wanted to do that in the first place. See, somebody else is thinking smart. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Come down here. Walk in over here. And what do we have in this doorway?
Is the med kit still in here?
The medkits are still locking those doors open. And in you have, at the moment, a very, very dark corridor. There's no lighting in the section whatsoever.
Hmm.
All right. What do I have? I have my eye. So I'll roll to hide and peek my ass in there. That's so not the right dice.
Nope, that would be a D8.
Yup. Yup. I realized that as soon as I grabbed it.
Thing.
That's not it. Oh my god. There you go.
Yay!
Yeah, I am having a shroud over here. Alright.
So, you have sneak.
16.
Yep, 16. Okie dokie. And could you roll a spot for me? Oh, that's good, that is.
I got to roll one as well, or just him?
Because he's the one going in there with his 60-foot of dark vision.
Okay.
Because it's a pitch black environment, you without the dark vision, I only get 10 foot of vision.
You can't see Dick.
Yep.
You can't see Dick. dude.
I take it you're going to be moving in and kind of looking around with your dark eye?
Yes. Yeah, slowly creep my ass around.
So you manage to get to about here, and you see a person lying at the end of the corridor.
Okay.
Okay.
I will slowly approach him.
I draw my floodlight, because I haven't used that yet, and it's in my inventory, so why the hell not? Walk through these doors, and I'll key up Ira, and ask if she has, Ira, do you happen to have any of your drones in this immediate vicinity that we have to be aware of?
Mutilated Microsoft Sam comes back to you, and responds with negative.
Okay. So we have no drones, or at least none that she has connection to.
So, right. Savrok moves up to the corpse, and Savrok finds Samuel.
Aww.
Okay. How did he die?
You do a cursory glance around him, and you can find no particular cause of death. If you'd like to do a proper examination of him, that's fine. Okay, roll a search for me.
Okay. 16.
So while he's doing that, I'm going to start looking through these lockers.
You're going to start looking through the different lockers and containers?
Yeah.
Okay, so... Savrok, you start to have a look through and around Samuel. The first thing you notice is that several pieces of Samuel's suit have been undone. And examining where the suit's been undone, you roll up his sleeve... And you find a list of high scores scratched into his arm. They appear to have been scratched in with some kind of scalpel.
All right. Oh, shit. We broke him so bad, he got so obsessed and killed himself playing game. Or similar. That's my initial thoughts on this shit.
you continue your exam, and you find... around his right wrist, several injection sites. You don't find any obvious cause of blunt force trauma or sort of mass blood loss. There's no gunshot wounds. You do notice that he appears to have, as far as you can tell, chewed a chunk of his tongue off.
He just happy drugged himself to death.
Meanwhile, Jake Long is digging through the lockers that are spaced around the wall. You find quite a few chemicals in the lockers nearest the entrance to the hydroponics bay. You find bags of seeds, a couple of spacesuits packed up into crates or into storage boxes. You find a few pieces of mechanical equipment. You've got a... pistol, a Tavok pistol, in one of the lockers.
Mm-hmm.
But unless you roll me a search, that's all you're finding.
We'll do a good search. We'll do a natural D20 search. No. We'll get the 2 part of that and nothing else. Stupid dice, you forgot the 0.
I'll roll the search then.
Okay, you're going to go through the cupboards.
God damn it.
And...
14.
Okay.
Oh, man.
So, Savrok goes searching in the cupboards, and in this cupboard here, Savrok finds a open panel behind the cupboard and a collection of circuit boards that appear to have been ripped out of a small computer array hidden behind the cupboard.
I will, I'll take them.
Okay, you're going to take, you get 3 damaged circuit boards.
Okay. Let me just write this down, my god.
Fuck. Are you yelling this out over the radio?
Yeah, no, this is open communication. Okay. We're here, yeah.
I'm going to come on over and not look at Sam as I turn the corner. And, let's see those circuit boards, and I'll I'll inspect them, try to determine what they are. What would I use for that? Like a craft mechanical to see what they are?
Craft electronics, because
craft electronics,
six.
Right.
Oh my god.
Six and my craft electronics, which is
three.
I got a nine.
You can tell that they're some kind of memory board. They have micro solid state memory chips arrayed up on them. They're kind of like a
space RAM.
Actually, they're more dedicated for. It's considered usually they'd be used for very, very high value data. Because they use quite advanced solid state drives. Each chip, which is roughly the size of about half the size of a credit card, or each block of memory that's roughly about half the size of a credit card, could probably store a couple of hundred gigabytes. And it sets them up in rows of 10. Remember that this is just, you're just storing basically text data. You're storing basically binary text data. They aren't big files that you have to store.
Yeah.
And it would store it 14 times in a row.
Okay. So a terabyte and a half per card.
Yeah, and this is massive redundant data storage.
Okay,
so I'm going to come back here and I'm going to peer around the corner and look into the airlock. Is it open? Is it closed? Is it partially jammed?
This airlock here is closed.
Did this one have windows through it?
It did.
Nope. No,
no,
this one
didn't. Oh, this one did. Shit. Okay, let me...
I'll pass through the first door.
I'm gonna circle out this way, and this one had a window in it, though.
It did indeed, because you peered through?
Yes, so I will peek my head through and see what I see that's get an immediate idea of there.
Okay. Immediately you notice that around the bottom of the door, if you look down from the window, there's a pool of blood. As well as that, as you look further into the bay, there is a body on the autodock, or there is someone on the autodock. You don't know whether it's a body or not. You can't identify it from that position and that angle. And there also appears to have been several bits of damage done to the room. There are little bits of black and sort of the flashes of extremely shiny metal where metal has been cut.
Okay.
Those people have freaked right out.
I'll go through.
Okay.
I step through as well.
And I'm gonna check out this body here, or whatever it is.
The thing lying on the table turns out to be the male wielding the assault rifle from the airlock.
Okay.
He's wearing his tac chest plate that you saw him wearing before. He has several wounds, and the autodoc is happily picking and puttering away at his wounds. Cleaning away his wounds. He's unconscious currently. His rifle is sitting on the floor next to the autodoc, and the autodoc is happily stitching away and dealing with several lacerations that he has around his face and shoulders.
I want to find a stimulant.
He's alive? Okay. Before that, I will take the gun away from him, as well as search through his pockets for any ammo or anything that can be a danger to anybody.
His pocket. Search away. Okay, and also, Savrok, could you roll me a reflex save?
Dumbass.
Savrok, could you take one damage?
Oh, yeah, sure.
So, Savrok starts, picks up the rifle, slings the rifle over his shoulder and starts fiddling through this guy's pockets. As he fiddles through this guy's pocket, he gets stabbed in the arm by the autodoc, because the autodoc doesn't really pay attention to the fact that he's rifling through the patient's pockets.
Yeah.
Okay. So I got a 10 on my search looking for a stimulant.
Yep. because you remember Blastoad where Savrok got all of his mm-hmm. chemicals from before, you find the chemical cupboard.
Nice.
You have no particular training in which chemical is which, but you find the chemical cupboard and it's full of chemicals. And in the meantime, Savrok disarms our gentleman of his pistol, which is a Tavrok pistol. And also finds his ID. He's a gentleman called Corbin. And he is
Corbin Dallas Multipass.
He's Corbin Dallas Multipass. He's Corbin Dallas Multipass. And he is a security officer working for Obsolife.
Okay.
So he's not a taxi driver. All right.
Yo, asshat, what should I be looking for to wake this guy up?
Epinephrine.
Okay. I'm going to look for the thing that he said.
Yep, you find epinephrine reasonably quickly. It's not particularly hard to find.
The auto dock, since we've played with its controls quite a few times, can I pause it mid-procedure?
Yes, you can activate a procedural stop.
Okay, I'm going to pause it and tie this guy to the table.
While he does that, I'm gonna
back to this again.
While he does that, I'm gonna wire up this door here with one of my explosives that I have on me, my battery bomb.
Okay, so you're gonna place your battery bomb there. And how are you going to wire into the door? Because they're very simple mechanical devices. Are you going to basically tie it to the door so when the door opens the mechanical device trips? Okay, so can you do me a quick craft mechanical, Savrok? Which would be for you a plus intellect roll, which is 11 plus 2.
11
so
plus
30.
2.
Yeah, that's it would be a DC of 10 to tie it to the door and get it to work. So yeah, you tie it so that this is going to... you have to crawl over the crashed buggy that's on that desk. Where is our crashed buggy?
It's where
right
is our truck?
I got it. Crashed into there.
My forklift thing.
Yep, so you tie your explosives to the door, so if someone comes to that door, it's going to trigger it.
Good. I'll come back over here and level my weapon at the guy who's tied down.
Okay. I'm gonna shoot him full of epinephrine.
Okie dokes.
Just adrenaline shot.
Okay.
I think he just died, didn't he?
No, he didn't die, but...
Okay.
Yeah. So that takes him from 16 down to... 3. Okay.
Okay, so I'm... God damn it.
There's a gasping sound, and his eyes fling open rather dramatically, and he thrashes for a moment. He doesn't seem to be paying a massive amount of attention to who's around him, but after a couple of seconds he calms down and looks to you two and kind of pulls at his wrists and just looks at the auto dock and then looks at Tuzio and oh fuck,
what the hell happened here? And the doctor will keep on going as long as I find some answers.
Okay, refusing medical help in return for answers. You're worse than me.
Okay, so Blastotoad, roll.
We just found Samuel, like, cut himself to bits over there. Everything shot to hell. There's no oxygen in here. This is worse than freaking space zombies.
It was Sudoku, man. That's what he was doing. That's it.
4. Still a higher intimidate than Savrok.
Oh, I can't even intimidate him because I'm going to have a shit fit. Oh, no.
You can roll a will save to try and do it.
Nope. I'm going to roll diplomacy on his ass. I'm going to try and reason with him. Seeing as how he's tied down.
So, now we're good cop, bad copping this bastard?
Pretty much.
Okay. So both of you...
Oh, 12. I got 12. Not bad.
12, yep. But it's 12 with a minus 6 because, you know, he's tied to a table and you just denied him medical treatment. That's what we call a circumstantial modifier.
Oh.
Gotcha. Fair enough.
Just like Blastitoad gained a circumstantial modifier to his intimidate for it. But yeah, this guy just stares at you two and just shakes his head and just says, Corbin A. Michaels, 113-4842, Obsidian Security.
All right, that's all we're going to get out of him. He's hard. He's military beyond military. That's like Black Ops sort of shit. So I'm just going to kill him.
No, don't kill him. What the hell, dude?
He's not going to be of any use to us.
So just let him recover.
No, he's involved in this in some way that is not good. He's part of the cause of this.
You are such an asset. Do not kill this bastard.
I'm shooting him.
No, you're not.
I've already got my gun. I've already got my rifle leveled at his face.
And I'm going to hold it down, and I'll have to punch you in the face again. There'll be no Samuel to fix this.
There is no. I'm just pulling the trigger while it's aimed at his face. That's it. There's no debate about it. It's done. His head is partially missing now. There is no debate. I have just shot an innocent man in the face. Not innocent, but I just shot a man in the face. There's no debate about it.
So, because he had his rifle, shotgun leveled, unfortunately, Blastoad, you don't have enough time to stop him pulling the trigger.
Oh, god damn it!
Roll A2 hit for me, Zavarrik.
If I get a 1, I'll be so salty.
15. And roll your damage.
I was going to do the percentile, but...
Oh, he's not a zombie,
I just damaged you guys.
Yeah, he's not a zombie, he's a living thing.
Right, and shock. Gun is 3-6.
Yep.
There you go.
Such an ass.
Six damage. Okay, so there is a loud crack bang, and a chunk of this person's head disappears. Fucking hell. You just shot an armed man who was tied to a table. You are a horrible.
You are such a bastard.
No longer going to be of any use to us. Once they start reciting their military numbers, that's it. You're not going to get anything from them. They'll try to impede you any way they can. I clean people. I know how shit works. Not my first rodeo.
What are you, home care now? I clean people. I know how shit works.
Okay, fine. I used to cut people up for work and make them talk. Once they reach that point, they won't talk no matter what you do to them. So,
okay, nah, there's regular means, and then there's freaking wiggly plants and flesh on the ground.
Yep.
Yep.
And that wouldn't have scared the shit out of him enough to say something?
Nope. He wouldn't have cared.
Such an ass. I'm going to check out this room. Such a twat.
Okay, I'll go disarm my bomb.
So, Blastitoad goes over to the door, and the door is closed. He opens it, and right in front of the door, in a place where you wouldn't have particularly seen looking through the windows, literally where you were standing, is the corpse of Ariana.
I bend over to see what happened. Just want to inspect, see, like, is she shot in the chest and or face, like the little dog girl, or, like...
Okay.
What's going on with Ariana?
So, Ariana is a bit of a complicated mess.
Oh.
Oh, no.
So, she still hasn't put a top on from the time you ripped her clothes off for her.
So, I was saving her. It was damn it. None of this is good.
No, none of this is good. Things. Let's put it like this: the dice and some of your own decisions have made this campaign go down a darker path than perhaps it might have had to. Okay, so you know I told you when the session wasn't before the session, Toad, that. I basically had a whole collection of things that Samuel might have done while you were away.
Yep.
and I rolled dice to determine what Samuel did. Well, Samuel appears to have used Ariana's back as a notepad to plan out several levels of his tower defense.
Oh God. Okay. What was her actual cause of death?
Roll a treat injury for me.
Okay, well, while he's trying to figure stuff out, I'm going to take a picture of her back. Oh, I might want to beat his high score, because fuck it now. Everything's so broken. It's like, oh, there's notes on this game. I will beat his high score, because he's an asshole. I shall defeat him in death.
Okay, so Savrok gets down to the medical exam of Ariana, and he finds hidden under her hairline a medium-sized puncture wound. You wouldn't expect this to be from a bullet or from a needle. This is more the sort of thing you'd expect from an ice pick, just below her left edge hairline, and it goes through the side of the jaw and up into the brain.
Death is pretty much instantaneous.
Yep.
Okay. So at least we got that. I mean, at least she wasn't like, you know, I don't know.
Just were you about shit. To say at least that, were you about to say at least she wasn't alive when that happened?
Yeah. Yeah. Roll at least she injury. Wasn't like.
Roll another treat injury.
As he's just talking out his stuff over the radio, I'm gonna check out the desk and stuff.
As far as you're aware, she wasn't alive when that happened.
I can deal with a three. Three is acceptable.
Okay. Because I saved this woman, and now I'm all pissed off, I come over here, I grab the body, and I start frantically shaking it as it's still tied to the table, yelling at it, tell us the answers, what the fuck happened here?
Is the autodoc still going here?
No, I paused it.
Aww.
But now I'm going to turn it on, see if I can't fix this bugger so I can get answers. Like, fix it. Just jabbing the fix it button. Heal this bitch. I jab him with another epinephrine.
60% of his head.
There's all this weird shit we've already seen here. I'm going to, like, go over, grab, like, three epinephrine shots and, like, jab him into his tits.
This is in character. I'm laughing my ass off at you because you're just desperately trying to fix this guy so you can beat the shit out of him more. Like, you're so angry.
They killed Ariana.
Who could have vivisected her?
Yeah, but, like, I ate a meal pack with her once, so, you know.
She was your cutie waifu?
The autodoc is administering shocks to try and boost up the person's heart. It's stitching up wounds. It's puttering away, trying to do what it can to repair damage. That's not going to do much considering he's had a shotgun through his head.
Yeah.
But it's puttering away. Several times his legs kick and like his arms twitch and pull on the cable you've used to tie him down. But those are autonomic responses rather than reasoned actions. So Blaster Toad's had a complete motherfucking breakdown.
Yep. Not shocking.
Meanwhile, Savrik's just curled up in the corner, pissing himself, giggling. So I think Savrik may have had a minor breakdown as well. Oh, dear.
Shit.
Okay, I'm going to start walking away.
All right.
Because, yeah, screw that.
Okay. So I picked up my bomb here, and I'm going to head through.
Okay. Kay. So in the corridor, you find several bloody footprints that weren't there the last time you were in the corridor, leading back towards the docking bays.
All right. I'm going to call out a radio that you know.
Okay. And while I slowly walk over that way, just a leisurely walk because I'm so freaking done again. We just started this day. Frick. Okay. So, as I'm just slowly walking my ass around, I hit up Ira on the comms. Hey, CompuSpace Crystal Bitch Computer. Sorry about that. That was probably mean. This crap's broken over here. Where would we, or why, or how would we do your comm thing so that we can just get off here? Like, start talking me through the comms repair. Because, screw it. Everything's broken.
Okay. So, Ira tells you that the comm system itself isn't damaged. The comm system has been locked out by the station command system. And that she doesn't have access to the comm system at the moment. You would need to bypass the command system and allow her access to the comms.
Yeah, so that's going to be in the command room, Ira?
Yep, that would be either via the command room or via the central computer unit.
Okay.
And roll spot for me.
20, 20, 20, 20. Roll a 20. Oh. Okay, just so that everybody on stream can see this, my last roll was a 2. Look at that beautiful number 1.
I'm happy with mine, so I mean, I'm not going to say nothing.
Okay. So, Savrak notices from where he's standing that in the arrival bay where there is the bank of standing access computers, you have 2 people standing among the bank of access computers.
Okay. I'm going to let you know that you have your gas grenade still.
Yeah, something like that, smoke grenade.
Smoke grenade, all right.
So I'm just slowly walking still, continuing conversation with Ira. Like, so, just like before we're setting this up, or as we're making our way over there, why drones? Like, why aren't the humans children of Mother? Like, why these hapless drones, which seem wholly inefficient or ineffective? Like, what's the reasoning behind that?
Hold up, Mother's back here.
Mother's companion has acquired drones.
Okay.
Companion without access to Mother creates drones.
Okay.
So Mother's the crystal, so if the crystal is embedded, then these become children? If Mother's included in the equation, I guess?
If Mother was included in drones condition, then drones would become children.
Okay.
Alright, so I'm literally telling you to stop moving, just back up into here. I'm going to roll to hide.
I walk into this little spot.
Just hide.
Okay. So now that I'm just like leaning against a wall because some dude told me to hide. Okay, so you say Mother wants to expand and like increase her knowledge and that stuff. What all would that entail? Like, once we leave here and you got network access, what's the big overarching plan? Like, what's Mother and her companion, I guess. Is that Father, or is that just companion? Is that like Bob down companion? The street, or like is that the plumber, or the pool boy, like? Or what's our relationship here?
Ira is slightly confused as to what Bob down the street means. She tells you that companion is companion. Companion and Mother have always been together.
Okay, cool. But like her plans, like as we continue here,
stop.
I'm just having my conversation and walking up to a corner, and then I'm leaning here. Leave me alone.
Yes, but there's people out there. I've filled you in on this fact.
I haven't seen them yet, and I'm just like leaning in a corner. I can't see them. They can't see me.
That's not always how it works. Kay. Just chill. What is the durability of my porcelain doll?
It's a porcelain doll. Like if you throw it,
can I? Okay. Can I slide it along the ground though?
Relatively. Yes, you can.
Okay, I will slide it into. I want to slide it into that wall there.
Okay. You're going to go porcelain doll bowling, but okay.
Yeah.
The hell?
Yeah, I want to just trust me on this. Just hold up. Okay, so does it distract either of their attention? Does either of them notice that shit?
They're both kind of in amongst the computers. Neither of them are looking towards you at the moment, and neither of them notice.
God damn it, that was a waste of time. Okay, I'm gonna sneak out and pick
so
up
as
my doll
he continues
again,
fondling his doll,
a rational person does.
I repeat my question to Ira. I was like, "What's the plan? Like, Mother's gonna be increasing mass and knowledge. What's her plan to complete that goal? Like, what kind of spread or effect is that going to have on surrounding systems?"
Mother's goal has always been to increase. Mother's goal is to become complete. So Mother must expand. Mother must consume additional.
If we could bring in a constant flow of mass for you, so you can keep expanding without actually leaving this moon or regular or this actual galaxy, I'll say, would that be acceptable as well? A non-stop flow of people.
The shit.
Consistent supplies of organic and mineral matter would be preferable.
Okay.
as you come to about this point.
Hell.
I wanna. Once we get off world, I want to make this into a privatized prison colony. We will be the sole proprietors. We'll be the wardens. We will own everything here. We will have complete immunity from Era. It will give us all its knowledge. Well, it will aid
us. As you're talking to me and I'm listening to you on the radio, I'm just walking away. Shit's wrong with you, dude.
Well, there's no way to destroy it, and it will eventually, you know, expand enough without our help. So why not quarantine it here and give it just the waste and dregs of society? No harm, no foul. We get rich in the process, and I mean, let's be honest here. It's a win-win-win situation. Everybody's happy, except for the people who are turned into zombie-like drones.
So let me get this straight. Like, Savrok's idea is to feed humans to the giant space crystal.
Only those who are going to be on death row or, you know, executed sort of thing.
Okay, how long do you think that supply is going to keep it happy? Like,
well,
a few months? Maybe a year?
It said consistent. Think about it. If we get enough, if we get every...
I could consistently eat freaking Cheerios, but having like three a day isn't going to satisfy me.
No, if every prison in the known universe where we are, essentially, we can have contact with all the regular people, all the regular societies, those who are advanced enough to have prison systems, if we get them to send all their death row inmates, all their the ones that they're essentially going to off themselves, send them here. They don't have to pay for food. There is no more. It's a giant win-win. There is no more prison. Have to roll any prison costs for those inmates.
Okay, Droid.
Roll initiative.
Giant bonus.
In this beautiful world of yours that you've created for us, do they like freeze their prisoners, or do they happy drug them, or do they do proper rehabilitation? Or do they actually still have just standard prisons where his stupid idea would work?
Depends on which colony you go to.
Okay, so they're independently governed like that. Okay.
Yeah, because in fact, on certain colonies, you would be looking at four or five different sort of methodologies behind it, because the different corporations. So on certain planets, you have up to 5 corporations operating. Each corporation operates its own private police force and its own private prison system, based upon how it thinks. For instance, if you were to go with the Freedom Group, then they operate a very interesting system of psychoneurometric drug management, and they basically, depending on how much of a danger you are to the rest of society, drug you into compliance.
And the worst of the worst?
They get drugged into a state of almost perpetual mind-numbed euphoria.
So they're essentially comatose?
To a certain extent, yes, essentially.
I see no difference. I see literally zero difference between that and my solution, except my solution means get rich too.
What initiative did you get, Savrok?
Oh, whoops. I did not hear that. Let's see, what do I get?
Such a dunce.
4.
Oh, some wow. Of a slot. So 6, 6, and 9. Lovely. wow, you guys, the dice are really not with you. So while you two have been arguing over what a disturbing thing or profitable thing it might be to turn this moon into a prison, the two people have finished working on the computer system, turn around and start walking up the corridors. Once they leave the computer system, you can recognize them as Chirachira and the person who had the pneumatic shoulder, the pneumatic shoulder array like Toads from the airlock. As they reach the point where they reach you, they both draw pistols, and you get a little beeping sound that means there is a open transmission being fed in the area, which you could tune your headset or tune your comms into receiving.
Okay. I'll receive it.
Answer the hail, Yahora.
Aurora. Open communication channels. So now Savrok is Uhura. Okay. I can see that. I think Savrok would look good in a miniskirt.
You and me both, man. You and me both.
I have a picture of you, like, all hanging out on my couch while you're asleep, and then putting you in a miniskirt doesn't fix that image at all. No. Would you be okay if I photoshopped that and put it in the open chat?
Sure.
Perfect. Perfect.
Okay, sure.
This is gonna be horrible.
Alright.
Okay. So, Chirachira's voice comes over the comms, and she asks you, she doesn't ask you, she says, what the fuck are you doing here? I thought you all would be dead by now.
I take a few steps forward. What the fuck have you done here? Everybody is dead here. The hell?
She has a little shrug and says, things went wrong. This is what happens when things go wrong in this situation.
But you... Are you just executing now? Like, how wrong? I don't see any more of the drones, space zombies, whatever you want to call them. I saw a kind of sad little girl who lost her dog, who's now dead in the airlock. And then you got another man in there that's all ripped to shreds on the auto dock.
She says that the young girl, and she says it with rather a contemptuous voice, and informs you that her name was Amanda, and that is what you should be calling her, had a mental breakdown and attacked one of them, and they defended themselves, and that the two people in the medical bay were dead when they found them.
Well, we didn't say anything about dead people in the medical bay.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, didn't you?
So she just mentioned that, so... Huh.
Okay, roll sense motives.
Hey, I had an 11 until he bumped me.
Yes, you did. I noticed.
Yeah.
Like, you asked that, I finally had a better than single-digit roll.
What did you roll, Savra?
I rolled an 8 plus 5, so 13.
Okay, so as far as both of you know, she's completely telling the truth, and you guess that she's probably been past the medical bay herself. Mm. And she probably knows of the dead bodies from the medical bay. She sort of smiles and well, she doesn't smile. She nods in your direction, and she says that basically her and her companion, who is called Kimla, they are both currently trying to get the station operational so that they can contact for help.
All right. Since they still have their weapons drawn, I'm going to quick switch to the assault rifle that I picked up, which I assume has a 40-round clip as well.
A 60-round clip, actually.
60-round. Okay. Can I get a counter with 60, then?
Yes, of course you can.
Let me fix it with bullets.
Dumbass. Nope. They have the weapons drawn. I am not firing anything. I am just being prepared.
Here we go. And 60.
Is there any other, or is there any more of this stupid mess going on down past here in the cargo hold? Or is what we've seen pretty much the brunt of it?
Are you asking me? Are you asking
Chimichira, as I'm on open comms.
Chimichanga? Alright, thank you.
Chimichira says that there's nothing going on back in the bay, but they needed to gather some circuitry from the computers out here to fix some damage done to the central computer.
Well, you're trying to get the comms back so that we can all get out of here. I think that's like common interest. Let's
What they know about what do they know about Mother Era?
Don't you frickin' dare, you what dumb do you shit. Know about the crystals?
No, what do they know about the crystals?
What like, more what do we need to know?
Crystals? That's it. No, I want to know what they know, because we've seen bodies with crystals in them. We don't know shit as far as they know. So what do they know about them? Explain this situation to me. What is the crystals? What do they mean? What are they doing? How are they involved?
Okay, so roll yourself a diplomacy check. See how convincing you can be.
Convincing with a 4.
Convincing of a 4 plus your diplomacy, which is 6. So 10. She sort of like rolls her eyes at you and says that they were using crystals for a research product. That's about all she knows.
We knew more, you dumbass.
That's obvious bullshit.
Yeah. Okay. So, peoples, at the other end of the corridor, you guys want to get this comms relay up? Let's do that. Let's get out of here. How about we, like, put down your weapons, because you notice I haven't drawn mine, and Twat Face over there will put his down, too. Let's just head over to the, you know, command room and go fix this stuff.
Chirichira agrees and thinks that it would be a wonderful idea for you to team up. After all, safety in numbers. She says that there's at least 7 or 8 members of staff from the station that still aren't accounted for as far as she's found. So there's probably still some unknown creatures and corpses moving about. So she agrees to team up with you. Yes, she agrees to team up with you.
Okay. Let's head on back.
So we're just going to take their word for it that there's nothing back there.
I don't care at this point. Let's get out of here.
I want to get rich. I want to make this. I want this. This is my prison planet, bitch. You can leave. I'm staying.
Saprock's gone completely insane.
Mm-hmm. He's nuts.
Then again, Blaster Toad's not exactly in the good condition himself.
No. And let's walk around the ways.
So, okay.
So you're headed down that way.
Mm-hmm. You just had to shoot the guy on the damn table, didn't you?
Yep.
Again, as said, whenever you guys do something that's a bad idea, you always roll high enough to succeed.
As soon as you roll a high number, you should be like, do I really want to do this?
Oh no, once you've rolled, I'm taking that as being done.
Yeah.
Why on earth... Oh god, you're still on 7 HP, Toad.
Yeah, I know.
Because of the amount of damage you took breaking into that other base. Yeah. Oh, crap. Okay.
Is he dead?
Okay. No, he's not dead. That's just not a good thing. Okay, so you're headed back to the... are you headed to the command operations center, or are you headed to the computer?
Okay, where do we gotta set this thing up? Are we going back over to command? I saw some stuff over there. Or are we hitting that up the computer? What do we need to do here, Chimichanga?
Chimichanga.
God damn it.
Okay, so Chirichira suggests that you go into the command center and she and her compatriot will go and deal with fixing the circuit boards in the computer. And then you can boot up the comms array from the command center.
How about we mix our teams?
Okay.
I'll go with Chirichira and you get the Karambit guy, whatever his name is, and then we'll go that way. Sort of an insurance policy here.
Okay, you guys want to split up? Okay, yeah. So you split up and you head towards your respective...
Okay, so who's going where?
You and engineer guy are headed towards the command computer because you're the engineers, and Chirichira and Sabrok are headed towards the comm center.
Okay.
So
and I'll walk behind her the entire way.
Okay. Is there anything you guys would want to do or say or anything like that?
I think right now the situation is tense enough without me opening my mouth.
Just
two dudes with mech suits walking down the hallway nonchalantly to a computer.
Okey-dokey.
I'm just walking behind her, watching her, making sure she doesn't try anything.
Okay. So you get into the Savrok and Chirichira get into the comms unit, the command unit. And again, several of the computers have had their screens blasted out. And there's fire retention chemicals all over the floor. And Chirichira goes over to one of the computers and starts fiddling about with the circuitry at the back because, of course, the screen's blown out. Meanwhile, Blaster Toad and Kimla arrive at the main computer, and Kimla pops in with several circuit boards and starts pulling out circuit boards, replacing circuit boards, doing bits and pieces with different circuit boards.
Hey, dude, what can I help out with here?
Does he still have the circuit boards? Did I get them back?
You've got the Savrok, I assume, because Savrok said he would take them after Toad looked at them. Savrok has got the memory boards.
Yeah.
Okay, so I still got them. Okay.
Yep. Could both of you roll spot for me?
Son of a bitch.
Two.
Son of a bitch.
Okay. So, also roll initiative. Because it's a fresh situation. We have Toad with a
15
and 22. Oh, yeah. 22 and 15. Okay. So, despite how high your initiative is, Savrok, when people act, they get it at the beginning of combat. Yeah. Without combat starting, they get what's called a surprise round, which is a round where the other people don't get to act.
Shit.
So, wrong dice. That dice. And then 2d6. Do I have 2d6? I know I have 2d6 somewhere. Okay, so Savrok, could you take, and this is not going to be good, could you take 8 damage, please?
Yep.
So at the start of combat, or the start of this round, what happens is Chira spins round and cracks Savrok right in the face mask with an ice pick. The face
that
mask.
Bitch killed her. Arya, or whatever. Or Arlene, or the medic chick that was actually a botanist.
I don't even know her name, but he's still angry. Oh my god. Ariana,
Ariana, yes. Adrian!
And, mask doesn't completely break, but it gets some ribbon cracks in it, and Savrok gets his head rattled about inside his helmet. And Toad got a 15, mm-hmm. but again, surprise round. So you, as a mechanical engineer, know the basic principles of working with computers and with mm-hmm. mechanical structures. You're pretty sure that what this gentleman has just done in his surprise round is basically connect two things together with a spanner that are frying, basically connecting two live sections of the computer that shouldn't be connected by something quite that resistant to breaking and capable of carrying quite that much current. And circuit boards start to go a nice black color as the computer starts cooking itself.
Nice.
And that was his surprise round. So next to act is Savrok.
All right, I'm just going to unload into her with the assault rifle. Just, nope, not dealing with that shit.
So what are you doing, Savrok? Are you firing once, or are you doing full auto?
Full auto spray at her chest.
Okay, so you are aiming at a short range with that. So let's do her reflex save. So she takes half damage. So 4d6, please. I think I need to give you an extra d6.
Yeah, I have 3 here.
Copy, paste. There you go. 4d6, and she takes half damage because she succeeded in her reflex save.
Come on, be nice to me. So, 5.5? I don't know how that works.
5. 4.5 rounded up.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, so next is Toad's turn. What are you doing, Toad?
Mech on mech action.
Yes!
I've never been so erect.
12 with my, what, base attack modifier?
With your
handheld weapon? Weapon. 11.
Yep, handheld weapon. 11. 23. You reach up and you grab your two pneumatic support arms, flick the switches, and on come the circular blades, and you ram them into this guy's back because he's still fiddling with the computer.
4 6s?
4 6s.
Oh my goodness.
He's messing with crap. 19.
Oh 19. My god.
Okay. Right.
I was going to magnetic coil ripper as soon as he radioed Chimichurri at Chip, whatever, that he had done the thing so that we can hit the comms. So this is just, like, I saw him messing with stuff. It's like, nope, you are already gone. You killed so many things.
The two circular blades slam into his back. He is wearing a tack vest, but a tack vest is not designed to stop circular industrial cutting blades. And this person is human, not a zombie. You don't have to sever his limbs to stop him from moving. You just sever his spinal cord and stop his body from working. Technically, he's not dead. He's technically just incapacitated to the point where he should be dead. If you were to attempt to, you could stabilize him and stop him bleeding to death over the next few seconds if you rolled high enough with your medical skill. Because you do have your emergency medical kit that comes with your spacesuit.
How deep a laceration did I make into his suit and his back?
He's not wearing a suit. He's wearing
a tack vest.
Tack vest and a small sort of in-station air mask. The laceration you made in was probably about an inch and a half deep. It was deep enough that you've severed several of his ribs and cut into his spinal cord.
Okay. What kind of give is there under his vest?
Underneath the vest, there's not a huge amount of give. There's a decent amount of give. If you tried to sort of force your hand under his vest, you could probably force your hand under his vest. What are you planning on doing?
Oh, I guess I left that in the other room. Damn it.
What?
I was going to shove my incendiary bomb up his back.
Okay. So carrying on with the rounds of combat, the next person to act would be Chira.
I'm so dead.
So Chira stabs at Savrok with her ice pick, and she has two attacks in a round. Okay, so she misses once, and the other one is a critical hit. Will she succeed in her critical hit? No, she doesn't succeed in her critical hit. Okay. So she still manages to do her double d6 damage, though.
7.
8 damage.
8? Oh, because she's...
Oh, 7, sorry. Yeah. No, sorry, 7. I rolled over. I saw it land on 2, and it must have tipped over slowly. Savrok takes a ice pick through his suit into his side ribs. And Savrok is...
Then
your round.
Yeah.
Your round.
I am going to... Shit. These doors are still open, yes?
Yes.
I'm going to book it back this way and... As I'm running, I'm going to drop that bomb of mine right in this general vicinity and just book it. Like, right, I'm going to drop it and run. Just drop it where I'm standing and just haul ass, not dealing with her shit.
Okay, so you take a full run action. You're in a medium armored spacesuit, which means that, or in a medium weight spacesuit, which means that you've got a run action of 3 times your distance, which means from where you're standing, which is here, you get, which is here, you get 18 squares, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There.
Okay.
Okay, so you drop the bomb, and the bomb goes off as she comes after you. By the way, have you guys got your comm open?
Yeah.
Yeah,
we haven't closed
we
it.
We have not said anything.
Okay, so...
He's probably heard me screaming going, oh my god, there's an ice pick in my face.
And I've just been silent as I sawed a dude through the back.
Oh my god.
Okay.
Just pissed. So... Up his back.
The bomb goes off and... Chira gets splattered with acid and small bits of metal around her ankles, but she's still coming. However, she's not able to take a full run action because she's still trying to come forwards within mind hitting you, which means she moves 6 and 6, which means she moves to there. So, Blastoed, it would be your turn.
I run, grab the spanner off the... Spanner? Wrench off the thingy-majig. Computer terminals.
Okay, so you run in and pull the wrench out. Roll a reflex save for me.
Whatever my stuff is, yeah. 5.
Yep. Nothing happens. You rip the wrench out and the computer stops systematically frying itself. In the meantime, you're just hearing Savrok just basically making whooping noises as he runs down a corridor with a mad woman with an ice pick chasing him.
Are you making Zoidberg noises?
Okay.
As he ignores us completely.
I'm just not. Shit.
This went sideways.
Yes, it did. She just let me start shooting everybody in the face.
So Savrok, your turn. Yeah.
Okay. This door is still open?
Yes.
Alright, I will shoot at her through the door and then keep running. And I will let him know that shit's gone sideways and I may need to meet him. And actually, I'll shoot and then I'll run this way into the cafeteria. So I need to meet you in the cafeteria ASAP. So she's trying to kill me.
You can move 6 squares, which would in a move action. So first you shoot. So you're standing here. You shoot. So roll a hit. You draw your weapon as a free action.
Oh, shit.
And he killed her with a dice.
thank God.
9 plus. Eight. Oh, eight. Yes, range 7. So you get a 16, which means you do manage to hit her. So roll your 2. Is this assault rifle?
Yep.
2d6.
All right, full auto.
You can't do it. You can't do a full auto as a standard action. You'd have to stand.
Okay, never mind then.
Stand there and spray it.
All good.
You're just firing a burst at the moment. Okay, so she collapses to the ground, bleeding from several bullet holes and from an explosion of assorted pieces of shrapnel and acid across her legs. She is also not dead. She is just rendered incapacitated and could be stabilized if you chose to treat medication on her.
Okay.
I just yell out over the comms, are you good?
I'm fine for now. I need to heal my own ass up, though.
Okay.
I'm wrecked.
When you're finished there, I'll meet you over in the command room.
Okay. So they're incapacitated. I'm gonna roll to heal myself before I go back there and start to worry about her ass. Like, I'll do the full.
Okay. 1d4 plus 2.
Okay.
From your medical equipment. 4. Gain 4 hit points.
Okay. So while he's doing that, I'm going to do a quick diagnosis on the computer.
Okie dokie.
So, craft electronics.
All right, I'm going to head back here with my assault rifle still in hand.
Craft electronics plus 3.
At all.
So, it's 18.
Okay, so Blastodon or Jake Long discovers that the central processing unit of the computer is still operational. Several of the processing subunits have been destroyed, and a large amount of the memory, which appears to be what the main purpose of the jury rig damage system the guy set up was aimed at, a large amount of the memory system for the station is completely burnt out.
Is the memory the same sort of cards that we previously saw?
It has some of those redundancy cards, but a lot of the memory would just be single redundancy SDS blocks.
Ah, okay.
So you've got basically sort of brick-sized solid-state drives containing a large amount of data, but without
much redundancy. We have to stop our session now. Gizmos and Brawlhalla, we must go over there.
Oh, no.
No, we're good. We're good.
So, like, are you going to try and stabilize Chirachira?
I am going to. Is she? I want to make sure she's unconscious first. Is her ass all the way out?
She's basically dying. She's losing 1 hit point every 6 seconds you wait.
Okay, I will run over there, take the weapon from her, and start trying to heal her ass. At least so she's not dying.
Really?
Right,
you're going to heal her?
Okay, I'm a stabilizer. That's it.
Okay. Yep, you make the stabilize roll, so she's no longer losing hit points. She is now an unconscious person in a very, very bad state.
Okay.
Meanwhile, the gentleman that Toad has sword in the back is still alive, just. He could be stabilized if you wanted to stabilize
him. So now that I know that the computer's good... As I'm walking past this bastard, I pull off his face mask and keep walking. He's just going to suffocate for his last few seconds.
Okay, so he's dead.
Such a dick.
Oh, come on. You just shot a dude that was tied up on a table halfway through a medical procedure.
Yep, he was no longer of any use to us. If he was a detriment, if he escaped, he would have attempted to side with them and kill us. I am glad I did what I did. Aren't you?
And now you're healing Shimichira, who actively tried to attack us.
Nope, I'm keeping her alive because I'm going to get what I want out of her.
We already saw her tits. What more do you want?
Nope, trust me. Just, can I roll to heal myself? No. No, she's stabilized?
So, she's stabilized, she's no longer dying.
And I have her ice pick. Okay.
Yep, and you've taken her off. You've taken off her, you've taken her ice pick.
How much min steel do you have there?
Since I've left one in the med bay now, I've still got two ropes of min steel.
I have one on me. I will hog tie her currently as tight as possible. I want it to be uncomfortable for her when she wakes
roll
up.
Roll a rope check for me. So that's 11 plus 3 for your dexterity, 14 plus 2 because you have escape artist. So 16. Okie dokie. So if she tries to escape, she's going to have to roll 16 or higher.
Okay.
Because she doesn't have any escape artist skills. Okay, right. So you have tied her up and she's lying unconscious. From her, you have taken an ice pick and you've taken a turret pistol.
Okay. Do you want to be here for this or not? Because I'm going to drag her into this room here and I'm going to get whatever information.
Just get to the control panel or control room or whatever so that we can do the comms thing and I'll meet you there.
I'll drag her in here by her hair. Just grab her by the hair and just pull her in here as I'm walking through.
Okay, so Toad, what are you up to? What's Jake Long doing?
Jake Long is walking into the hidden armory.
Yep.
Okay. Jake Long is donning himself a military armored spacesuit, because we saw those in here, and transferring my current oxygen to it.
Okay.
And then Jake Long is going to take a look at the big-ass depth charges that you said with a few together could do massive damage, wipe this place out, and see if there's any way to set a timer on them.
Please don't.
Okay, so...
Are you sharing this, or are you just going...
No, I'm not. I'm silent. I just said I'll meet you in the control room, and I'm completely silent.
Roll a fortitude save for me.
Ten with fortitude of 8. So 18.
Okay, so Jake Long goes into the armory and starts stripping off his suit. As he strips off his suit, he removes the oxygen system that he's currently using to breathe and steps into an extremely low pressure, low oxygen environment and inhales sharply. Exhale sharply, and then sort of while getting into the next suit has to spend a small period of time surviving in a environment with 30% pressure, so 0.3 atmospheres of pressure.
That sounds because of this, pleasant.
Because of this, Jake Long has a very, very unpleasant experience, and unfortunately, Jake Long's constitution, although he's quite a tough bugger, is not ridiculously brilliant, and Jake Long takes a single point of constitution damage, which means you get one less constitution.
Oh, okay. So not hit points, but constitution damage.
Well, the disadvantage of this is because that constitution damage has taken you down to a plus one instead of a plus two, you lose one hit point for each level. So you're going to lose 6 hit points.
What?
Because constitution gives you one hit point per level.
Oh, shit.
However, you do get a nice armored spacesuit, which increases your armor class from 18 to 20, which is a nice little benefit.
Yeah, you know, trade off 6 hit points for 2. That's freaking awesome.
But 6 hit points for 2 armor class. Oh, sorry. Yeah, your armor class is up to 21. Now. So you're harder to hit. People have to roll higher on the dice to hit you.
Squishy.
May have become quite squishy.
Okay, so do I have to roll anything to figure out if I can set a timer? Or do these things just have like a big countdown piece of shit on them or what?
You're not military, but you have used detonation charges before in your previous work as an atmospheric low atmosphere engineer. These are military grade versions of basic splitter charges. They are military grade versions in that they're probably about 500 times the size of the splitter charges you're used to using, mm-hmm. but they use the same basic technology, which is they use either a radio signal or a timer to detonate.
Okay.
While he's doing this, can I heal myself up anymore at all so I'm no longer mostly dying?
Nope, you've healed yourself as
Didn't
much as you
can. Your medkit. Some of it.
So, these things here, if I trigger one, will it cause a chain reaction with the others, or do I have to set up multiple?
It would trigger a chain reaction with the others, considering each one's designed to wipe out and properly wipe out a sort of 50 to 60
okay.
foot area around it. Cause
the door
damage.
Behind me, is it sealable?
It is.
Okay. I set up a... ...22-hour timer on these units.
Okay.
And then walk out the door and seal that compartment back up.
Alright. While he's doing his whole bullshit thing, I'm gonna wake her up by lightly sticking her in the side with the ice pick. Not enough to break the skin, but enough to be a choke to go. Get your ass
wake up. That would kill her.
Okay, she's at that level. Okay.
You would actually have to roll a treat injury and attempt to heal her to wake her up.
I will do that. I will treat injury. Okay.
Some critical failure.
Oh no.
Right. This is a dice. I'm going to tell you this straight off so you know I am in no way fudging this whatsoever. She has a +2. She has a +2 fortitude save. She must roll at least a 10 or instantaneously die from your critical failed medical treatment.
Okay.
So 8+, 8+, 8+, 8+, 8+.
Run!
So she essentially just exploded.
Now, you go over to her and you attempt to basically medically treat her enough that she's going to wake up. Bearing in mind that she's had bullet holes in her chest and things, for some reason, despite your medical training, you decide that it would be necessary to remove some of the bullets to help treat her, and you attempt to remove one of the bullets and push it further in and pierce her heart, and she dies.
Okay, shit.
So
all I hear over the radio after this time. Shit.
Yep.
I mean, it's better for her this way because I would not have been nice. It was gonna get dark.
Oh, those fucking hey. Like you two have even infected me. I'm rolling shitly.
Like, what even was that? God damn it!
Oh man.
Okay.
Double critical
failures. Can I request a redo on this bullshit? Because what was that? Nah, that's okay. Well, she's dead. I'm just gonna let you know she's dead. Did you bring me that other armored suit, or did you just leave it there like a dick?
Oh, I forgot about it. I was doing stuff.
You're a dick. All right, so you're the computer guy. I'm gonna leave you the circuit. Not screw it. I don't give a shit. Let's just fix this.
While I'm here, I want to use one of my med kit things that I picked up to try to heal myself.
So you can roll treat injury on yourself if you want.
Which is a what
number? Or you can give it to me and I can treat injury on you. But I also might kill you. Yeah. So I mean...
So is it a 20?
A d20, yep. And it is plus wisdom? I can't remember actually. I think it might be plus wisdom.
8 and... plus 0. So an 8.
that is not high enough for you to heal hit points. Now, I'm going to, again, full disclosure, I'm actually going to focus rules this time. It says that if you attempt to treat injury on yourself, you can then not again attempt to treat injury using a med kit for a certain period of time. However, you've rolled so low that I'm going to classify that as not actually attempting to treat injury on yourself. You just kind of slapped yourself with Medigel. If Savrok tries to treat injury on you, I will actually allow him to, even though the rules say I shouldn't, I will actually allow him to treat injury on you.
You want me to give it a shot?
So I'm sitting there just rubbing freaking gel on myself, I throw a kit at you and be like, fix me. Just sitting propped up against the door. Oh, you! 12!
Plus 14, though. I have a treat injury of 14.
And you actually do manage to break the DC 15 for a medikit heal.
By one?
By one. So, 1d4 plus 2.
Okay, I guess that's me that's good.
Yeah, I get four hit points.
Okay.
I love the fact that, you know, the bad guys are damaging people for, like, 8, 12, 14 damage, and you guys have 7 and 5 hit points.
Yeah. Yeah. Alright, so, are we going to get to work on this computer, or can I go back to making
what did I have left,
my
like
own personal
5, prison? 5 or 4 radios left?
You had 4 radios left, because you got 8 radios, and you had 4 radios and a camera available to you.
Okay. So, let's start looking at computers and find one without a shot-out terminal.
Okay, so
that would be a
search desk.
Really? I can't just walk around the room and look for something that's not shot?
Yeah, but you can find the non-shot-out things, but you're trying to find a working computer.
16.
And that would actually mean 16. So roll an electrical for me as well.
Which is what, a plus 3 for me?
Yep.
Yes.
5. Okay.
Come on, guys.
As you go around, right. you find a couple of computers with screens. There's the one that Chirichiro was working on. As far as you can tell, none of the computers are... Well, none of the interface terminals are particularly bad damage, bearing in mind the computing system is the central computer for the base. As far as you can tell, nothing is massively badly damaged within the computer terminals, apart from the terminal screens being shot out. So the terminal should work. The central computer, however, Blaster Dojo, you are aware, had a majority of its memory core burnt out.
Yeah. Memory's gone, but you should still be able to transmit with it. I'm hoping. All right.
While he's doing that, I'm going to key up Ira and let her know that Chirichiro and her followers are dead.
Okay,
they attacked us, and they are dead.
Ira is extremely pleased that Chirichiro is dead. She tells you that Chirichiro was the command scientist for the base doing research, and that Chirichiro was a threat. With Chirichiro gone, the threat has been removed, and with the threat removed, Mother is now safe.
Okay. And yeah. I just want to, as I'm digging around and stuff, reconfirm with the heirs, like, with Mother being safe, our standing agreement still stands, correct? As a question.
Yes, the standing agreement stands, the trade agreement of connection to a long-range communication system in exchange for a travel ship capable of magnetic resonance travel.
Okay, so we're working on the relay right now. Was the ship fitted as I requested?
Ira agrees that the ship has been fitted, and that Mother's children have been working on making sure the solid burning fuel rockets are firmly attached for breaking orbit with the planet.
Okay, thank you for your cooperation. Let's get you talking to the world. Or at least set up to. Okay, so with my thing, what do I gotta do now? Because I rolled low on electrical. Like, I know it's not broken.
But... Yep. So it now comes down to computer use, that dreaded thing that Toad and Savrek have failed at every time they've tried.
Mm.
You can.
Okay.
Would there be any sort of direct lines which would be triggering something to the communications from here? Like, could I set up a remote switch with my radios if I crafted stuff?
Not from here. You'd have to do that from the
computer's
main terminal. Yep.
So.
Okay, I'm gonna go back there. Actually, I'm gonna use my pretty pink highlighter that I had with my notepad and draw
you
out.
Yourself, not me.
Draw out my plan for Saravok, the hand-cutting shotgun-facing dude. Oh, you killed the dude on the table, damn it.
He was of no use to us. I have no regrets.
Whatever, shut up. Draw out for him.
You shot a dude in half.
Yeah, shut up. That I plan on doing a remote relay switch to hand off to the, mutant monkey dudes before we fly off, so that they are hitting their own switch as we fly away.
Okay, so I'm gonna stop you right there, because...
Exactly, just like that.
You're basically wanting them to blow themselves up.
No.
Under the guy.
I'm giving them a remote relay to the transmission terminal.
It's just
a remote relay to the transmission, yeah.
Okay.
There's the picture I drew.
Us in a spaceship,
me with my third leg because Jake Long. To the transmission terminal with a button. Thank you for that, droid. We needed that levity.
I thought you just filled me in that you made bombs, and I was like, dude, why are you telling me this?
No, you don't know about bombs. Oh, shit.
That's what I was like, that's how I was so confused. Okay, then yes, I will. Yeah, alright, how can I help with this idea? What can I do?
Stand ready at the terminal, Saravok. So I'm saying this as I'm walking away. I'm just gonna finish up some stuff at the computer here, and then you can, I'll tell you when to, do the thing, since you got computer use, HackerBot laptop. You better still have that. You didn't drop that somewhere, did you?
I did not drop shit. I haven't dropped anything.
Except for the ball. Well, bam!
Except for the...
I dropped my ball on you, slut.
Critical fail.
Yeah.
8 plus my craft electronic 3. Oh, that's not going to do it. So
11.
On 11?
Okay, so... So you go over to the computer and you start fiddling around with the computer, and your objective is basically to rig up a remote control to turn on the comm relays and to rig up a remote connection to the comm relays for the long-range communication systems. That you can do pretty easily, but you come across the same issue that you came across when you sort of first went into the communications room, which is that the comm relay has been locked out. You can interact with the circuit board, you can interact with the system. As far as you know, the system is fully operational, but the system has been locked from use.
The software system's been locked from use, but I can set up a mechanical or hardware relay to do like a break connection on that, correct?
Without having to actually
be it on.
You could set up a dead transmission where basically the long-range communication relay would just blanket transmit whatever was given to it.
No, what I'm looking for is not a connection to it, but like a relay switch or a solenoid. Like, as soon as the second radio is keyed up, it turns switch on, so transmissions can be made. And then Ira has her connection.
You can set up a direct connection so that they can turn the long-range transmission system on and off, but the long-range transmission system is on. It's just the system has the sort of software and the program system that runs it has been locked out.
Okay, perfect. So I've got my switch then. That's all I needed.
Yep, you've got a switch that will turn the long-range communication on and off. The long-range communication tower is currently on.
Okay, I want to turn it off. And then tell Saravok, so, yeah, thing's done. Over here, it's looking good. If you can please, you know, do the thing. Like, get us into the comms.
Okay, so roll. Watch me get a 1. Oh, shit.
18. Plus 2 from the computer thingy.
Plus 2 from the machine, and plus your intellect as well, which,
Is...
For 20. Nice. So we 22. Can do stuff.
Okay, so Savrok sits down at one of the consoles, sweeps off the remnants of the fire retardant materials, and starts working away. He plugs into one of the connection ports the computer interaction program, or the computer interaction docket that works with the system and basically attempts to bypass things for him. He manages to bypass the grade lockout and manages to gain some minor control of the communication system, long-range communication system. The long-range communication system was locked out by Chiritura. And when you regain control of the long-range communication system, you gain almost immediately a screen message from Chiritura. It is a text message, and it's marked with Chiritura at the top, and it has Chiritura's code. And it is a set of information, a long page. Now, I'm going to give you guys the choice of reading it or just going straight on and gaining control of the...
I would like to read it.
Read the thing.
Okay. So, the message starts off with, I am a scientist working for ObsLife at the ObsLife Research Facility. That this message.
Or wait, one second. Is Saravok with your brief look over your message before you start like getting into depth with it? Are you just gonna read it out over the comms as I'm walking back, or are you gonna call me over to read this stuff?
I'll read it over comms. That's
okay. Are you sure that's a great idea? With you know, like Era listening to everything.
I'm reading over comms. I'm fully in agreement with working with Era. I am reading a comm on what was written previously. I'm saying this is what Chiritura has written on this comm. There is no preamble, just straight up. Here's the facts. Continue on.
Yep. We discovered a large crystalline structure and discovered a computational matrix capability within the crystalline structure, and we were detailed with researching this structure's ability and the structure's capabilities and use as a long-range communication computational matrix. We discovered a symbiotic life form living on the crystal that appeared to be a unimulticellular symbiotic parasite. And we began research into use of these things, use of these two creatures or these two items as ObsLife requested. As research went on, we discovered that both the crystalline structure and the multicellular organism attached to it in a symbiotic fashion had a degree of intelligence that was concerning. ObsLife changed the research protocols. Security details and additional security equipment arrived. The research project went wrong, and the crystalline entity and the attached symbiotic entity proved to be extremely hostile to life. Because of this, the research project was shut down, and I was received orders from ObsLife to enact burnout where all research data, all people associated with the research, and all research materials were to be destroyed. If this is currently in existence, if this station is currently in existence, I urge you to follow through and to not allow this the research subjects, the crystalline entity, or the multicellular intelligence life form, to gain access to any form of transportation or long-range communication, as this could prove a threat to the long-term existence of mankind. I have placed this message here behind the lockout of the communication systems. Do not activate the communication systems.
Okay, so he's just read that out over the thingy. While he's been reading that, what I was doing moving around here was grabbing one of the welding attachments for my arms, or torch attachments, so that I can hit some spot welds on here so that door is well and sealed.
Okay, so you're welding shut that door. You are a sort of ex-low orbit engineer, so you have capabilities of welding without particular effort.
Okay. So and then since he's finished his letter there, I want to reach out to Ira again, and now that we know she can hear us everywhere. Just in no particular manner, it's like, yo, Ira, you gonna be an issue, like, to life and humans and stuff and our independent ongoings, or are we good?
Ira replies with the fact that Mother requires material and expansion. Mother requires to gain material and expansion, but the existence of human beings is not contraindicated by Mother's desire to gain material and expansion.
Okay, can we have at least a temporary agreement of no expansion with the use of human material? There's plenty of other life force out there that you can deal with. Just make a little deal. Let's go for like a, you know, what's short term for you? Like 100 years? You're a crystal. You could go on for a while.
Ira agrees. One second, I just have to roll some dice. This is the dreaded DM roll.
What happens? Does she screech in her face again? Be like, no, I'm going to rape you all?
Chirachira agrees that human beings are not necessary for
Ira
expansion.
And Mother?
Sorry. No, Chirachira? Ira, sorry. I'm getting fucking confused with the fucking name. Ira agrees that human beings are not a necessary source of material for expansion, and she's shown to be true to trust as far as you can tell, so there's no reason for you to doubt that. She suggests that large amounts of animal life, crystalline form, crystalline structure, seems interested in perhaps gaining access to a bioorganic silicon source. So human beings aren't necessary for her plans.
Okay, perfect. So we can agree on a temporary ceasefire then? Like, can we put a date on that?
The level of intelligence and the smarter the creature is, the fewer are needed to achieve the same result.
No, because it's all based on mass.
It's all based on mass. It's based entirely on mass.
Okay, so we get some giant-ass elephants, drop them on this planet, they're happy. Essentially.
Essentially, yes.
Essentially, okay.
Just gonna, like, genocide the elephants for space zombies?
Dude, it's a zombie space zoo. How baller?
Space zoo.
Come on.
Well, you've already got a capuchin exhibit and a gorilla exhibit.
And that horse.
You've got pony rides.
And hey, it's not like a harem bee can happen. You know, you shoot it a couple times, it's just all good.
Get your dicks out.
Oh, Christ. So, guys.
Jeez.
With the bomb set on a timer, with the comm system turned off, but the lockout disengaged, and a message from Chirachira asking you not to do this, and Chirachira lying dead on the floor, having received the worst medical attention since the existence of man. What would you guys like to do next?
Okay, so I'm going to walk over and meet this dude over here.
I'll just wait for him. That's
okay.
It.
He's just waiting.
I'll just wait. He's the computer dick. He knows what he's doing.
I walk over here.
Apparently.
And I give her a swift kick in the faceplate. Because nothing but problems from that one. And hey, Ira. In like a couple seconds here, big question is, like, we've got the long-range comms set up here. Do you need any sort of other connections, or are you already set up to use this?
Ira states that basically the short-range communication system between the two bases is perfectly happy and functional.
Okay.
And she can piggyback on that.
Okay, well, let's get over to the airlock.
Okay. Yep.
Get out, refill my suit.
Yep.
Oxygen.
Psh, compressed water. No, oxygen.
Oh.
Shit.
Okay, so we're outside now. Okay, Ira. We're going to run a quick test on the, temporary test on the, relay system, and, just tell me if you can, sense connection. And I turn it on for 1 second and then back off again with my relay switcher.
Okay. Ira agrees that she can sense the connection to the long-range communication network.
Okay, perfect. We'll meet you back at ASO or Casa de Crystalline Computers. Why not? Jump in my moon buggy. Look. Moon buggy.
You having a stroke?
It's kind of a messed up situation we've got ourselves into.
I was like, well, never mind. Okay, there I am.
Okay.
Okay, so you hob into your moon buggies, and who's driving the moon buggy?
I'm going to let Sarah drive the freaking moon buggy. I am so done with dogs.
I want you to have another mental breakdown.
Actually, dude, after I got into my car the other day, and this song, what was it? You make me breathless or something was one of the lyrics that like came on as soon as I turned on my car. I'm like, god damn it, Droid did it in real life to me too. Or you take my breath away. That was it. You take my breath away.
You got a natural 3 for your piloting skill, and you have pilot of 4, so you got a 7. Thankfully, it does have GPS, and you have driven this route before. So, although it takes you perhaps an extra sort of hour, or let's say 2 hours longer than it should have taken you, you managed to get across to the secret moon base.
So there's like
you've essentially
18 or like 17 left. Hours, 19 left.
Okay.
Okay, so we actually didn't spend that much time in that base then, okay.
No, after you set the bombs, like you remember, you set the bombs after you killed everyone.
Yeah.
All you did then was spend roughly 45 minutes or so jury-rigging the computer system.
Bullshitting.
Okay.
And messing about and reading messages from dead people. Mm-hmm. Like,
did you take a screenshot of that?
I did not.
Screenshot of what?
Oh, we got cameras in our suits to like, oh no, we don't have cameras. We just got like internal voice recorder. Oh, we've got that on an internal voice recording. Yay. Yep. Now every time I want to listen to that message, I have to hear Sarah Vox's voice.
Re-record it. Or type it out.
Yeah. I'm going to go hire Matt Damon to read that for me because that's less annoying.
Matt Damon.
Okay. Anyway.
So now we're here.
Yes, we are here.
So, what's happened is you've set up some bombs to go off. You've driven around the moon surface for a while. You had a bit of a joyride, you know. You went the scenic route. It was nice and relaxing. Can you both roll a will save for me?
Really? She said we're all good. What the hell is she gonna do to us now?
No!
9 and my will of 2. So 11.
I get 1 plus 8.
Okay. So, you're not gonna like me.
Shit.
Is this a mental snap or is the computer gonna backstab us?
It's a mental snap.
I think that's still better than computer backstabbing us.
That depends.
How badly do I get wrecked?
Because, you know, I do this thing based on, like, I roll dice against which skills. Mm-hmm. And you both failed your will saves. So, Saravok.
Yeah.
As part of your mental snap, you win what's behind door number two.
Which is the horrifying sort of thought of carving the high score table and the images of a video game into someone's flesh every time you try and treat somebody's injuries.
No! Shit! Son of a bitch. I hope you get it worse.
That's kind of hilarious, though. Like, every time you go to hell, no wonder you just, like, killed Chimichara. Or Changa, or whatever. Chimichiri. Cheerio, bitch.
I killed the burrito!
But anyway, yeah, you're like, I'm gonna do this, but... Yeah. Oh, no! If I don't, like, make an incision directly under high score at, like, 3,500 points, then, like, I'm gonna nick this artery right near high score 2,400 points, and then she'll die.
GG.
So,
bitch.
Toad, you didn't succeed your will save either.
Yeah.
You slut.
So,
Oh. Okay.
Again, whenever you try and, repair or build a mechanical device.
No. Ah. Wait, mechanical, not electrical?
Mechanical, not electrical.
Okay.
Whenever you try and build or repair a mechanical device, you will just end up getting just the basically in your mind's eye, you will just be standing in front of those bombs you set up to explode, just ticking down in front of you. And you'll just have the sensation of white hot flame washing over your body for a few seconds.
Hmm.
Nice.
So just to bring people in on this, if this is the first one they've watched, I'm working with a kind of rules-based psychological damage system that I found where they have mental snaps periodically. They can will save to resist the mental snap, and each time they fail a will save, one of their skills gets a DC 15 will save against use. And to freshen it up with a little bit of roleplay, every time Blastoise's character Jake Long attempts to pilot a vehicle, he hears the last dying barks of the dogs he suffocated to death.
Yeah, I spacewalk them.
Every time he tries to use the survival skill, he has the image of crawling gorilla back flesh from the zombie gorillas that appeared to be semi-mobile and was able to grip things. He has the image of that, and whenever he tries to craft mechanical things, he has the feeling sensation of an explosion. And Savrok, who succeeded one of his saves, only has two. He has the treat injury, high score cutting issue. And whenever he tries to intimidate someone, he has a zombie gorilla screaming in his face, in his head. So, we have lots of mental damage.
Okay. So now we're here. Shit, what is the plan? Do we want to just jump in the ship and let them take care of themselves, key it up, give them control? Or do you want to stick around here for a bit longer?
No, I'm getting the ship's still behind the place.
Yep, the ship is still outside behind the place.
Okay, let's go inspect the ship.
Yep.
Like, you know, Ira, I would say hello, but like you're a computer and you can't wave at me.
Oh.
So I'm just gonna go check out the ship back here and see everything's good. How are you doing though? Had a nice like afternoon in your metal shell case thing. Yeah.
You go around the back and you look at the ship. The magnetic coil has been attached. It's got a pair of orbital escape rockets basically bolted on the side. As far as you can tell without doing a closer inspection, it looks fine. It looks working. Are you going to spend the time and the...
I'm going to spend the time to inspect this bugger. Like, pre-flight inspections 101. I got my space license.
Alright.
Except for, yeah, gonna, screw that. How about you inspect it, because I got a 3.
Yeah. Son of a bitch.
Whatever. Okay, so it appears to all be sort of set up to work fine, as far as you can tell.
Can I just take the time to, like, look over it? Or now yes, that I rolled, can. I can't. Okay, I'm just going to take the time to look over it.
But, roll a will save for me.
Both of us or just him?
Oh, this is my mechanical check.
Yeah.
What am I supposed to, like, not mechanical. See again?
You are going to see a... basically, you're going to get trapped in the explosion of the bombs you set up to explode.
Yeah, no, I'm not. I'm going to have an awesome will save here.
Nope.
With my will of plus 2. So 12.
So, you have a mental snap, so it takes longer than you wanted to. So... You start to inspect the ship, and as you start to inspect the ship, you fall to your knees, and the sensation of white-hot flame washes over you and scalds your skin. And then you have a moment of just, like, screaming in agony until a few seconds or a few minutes later, the agony just vanishes, and you're fine again.
And I'm going to walk on inside the ship just for taking a look on the inside while he's outside being little homo.
So... You go around the ship with a reasonably fine tooth comb. Takes a while. The rockets have been attached with reasonably well done connections. They appear to have been welded on in certain places as well. So the rockets attach quite well. The magnetic resonance coil, the superconductive magnetics system that allows it to connect to the magnetic lanes, appears to be attached reasonably well. You do find a couple of small sections that need perhaps a little bit of tidying up, and you set about doing a little bit of tidying here and there to make it work, a little to make it connect a little bit more efficient, and everything seems to be in order.
Nice.
Okay. I'm inside, and I'm just waiting to go. That's it. I'm just sitting in the chair spinning. I'm just done. I'm just screwing it.
You're going to have, like, a nice conversation with your new robot overlord, you know, about payment and values and ongoing relationship. And or you're just going to be like, yeah, I'm going to provide you mass. See you soon.
Yeah, I'm making it into a prison ship. I need to take care of the proper authority, get through the proper authorities and everything. I will have to deal with that once I'm out there.
Okay, so since you've been, like... through the airlock of a ship and all that, are you getting comfortable and taking off your spacesuit and doing your thing?
I am gonna open up my mask and I'm just gonna relax. I'm spinning in a chair. I'm bored. I'm waiting for this ship to get going because I want to make some bank. I'm tired of being poor.
Okay.
I'm just tired of being poor. I want to make some bank and just own a prison planet. That's gonna be so pimp. I'm excited.
Okay. Keying up Ira again. So, Ira, where has Cheetah got to? And of course, when I'm saying Cheetah, I'm referencing George of the Jungle, the monkey. So, gorilla man.
Okay.
That was the longest reference ever. God damn it.
Yeah, that reference was...
lost on everybody.
Yeah.
That was like Cockney rhyming slang, but like third level Cockney rhyming slang.
It was like you were a spastic, man.
Like, you have Cockney rhyming slang, which is apples and pears, which means staircase or stairs. So apples and pears, stairs. Second level rhyming Cockney slang would be to say apples, because you don't have to say the second bit. Like apples and pears, stairs. Third level Cockney rhyming slang is to say something like, you know, greengrocer, apples and pears, stairs. That's how bad that reference was. That was like,
wow.
I don't quite.
Nobody remembers George of the Jungle? Come on.
Yeah,
we do, but dude, come on.
It's George of the Jungle. George of the Jungle, strong as he can be.
Yes, but the cheetah, like.
Yeah.
No, not even gonna go there.
Fine, I just confused the hell out of everybody. I'm broken. I had a mental snap. of when I thought I was burning under a ship. So that was awesome. So yes, things aren't quite coming out straight. So I was like, where's Cheetah?
So you're sitting there screaming into the mic, where's the Cheetah? That's it. That's all he's doing is screaming into the mic.
Where's Cheetah?
That retarded.
She's probably a bit confused. And then I have to school her on pop culture. So we have that little discussion.
This is just, like, the funny thing is about this campaign, I'm just going to just pause the campaign for a split second. The funny thing is about this campaign, I was just sitting here while you two were having your little rant, thinking how differently this campaign would have gone if things had turned out differently in the first and second episodes. Like, this campaign would have gone so different. I will save that for the question and answer that we have planned. So, Ira says that one of Mother's children will come and greet you.
Okay. And, preferably one with fingers, because I got a present for you.
After a little while, a horse comes around the corner with a capuchin monkey sitting on its back.
Yes.
I was thinking, like, a horse came around the corner, and I'm like, seriously?
Yeah. I was like, really? What, fingers where?
Well, you know, like, amorphous flesh. It could just be like, put it on my back and I'll dial this thing up. Beep, boop, boop, boop. I'm so done.
It trots over and chirps at you again, despite the fact it's standing on the surface of a atmosphereless planet. Mm-hmm. It chirps at you and tilts its head to the side, and the capuchin climbs up onto its head and also tilts its head to the side, examining you.
Is there any fur left on them?
Yes, this fur.
Okay. So, first thing I do, I go up to the little capuchin. I, like, make a fist, but, like, extend my index finger. I, like, rub the inside of my knuckle on its chin. And just kind of grin inside my helmet. I always wanted to touch a monkey. Just monkey time.
Thank you. Now you're molesting monkeys on the surface.
Yeah, then I like scratch its chin a little bit and present it with a radio, a jury-rigged radio. Like, there's your key to the city. Like, there you go. You're all like special now. You can now talk to people. You know, don't dial 911. It'll get you in trouble unless you got a real emergency. Like, give the little monkey a lecture. Like, here's how you use a phone, Simon. Just deal with it. Monkey's name's Simon now.
The captain takes the radio off you, and the horse and the captain return the way they came.
Okay. I get up into my spaceship after watching dead things trot off.
So you two are now in the spaceship. What would you like to do?
Is there any sort of medical supplies or med station on the spaceship?
It's the little planetary transport shuttle, so unfortunately not.
No?
Alright. You have your...
I should have grabbed something when I was back there.
Alright, I will jump into the pilot's chair and not touch anything yet. I'm going to queue up Ira and say... Happy, I'll be back with people. I'll be back to get this set up as a prison ship, prison planet. I want this to be mutually beneficial. I hope you're excited for things to come.
Okay.
That's it.
Chira agrees that beneficial situation of additional mass for Mother. Greatly appreciated.
Ira.
God damn it.
Yeah.
I have that stuck in my head.
And I want to see, how will I be compensated for the threat to my life and the damage I have physically taken and my psyche has taken while setting this all up? I want complete immunity from any sort of whatever plan she might have. I want complete immunity. I've known she's been trustworthy so far, and I've trusted her completely so far. once she's proven it. So I just don't want to become a zombie thing. That's it. Just don't crystal me. That's all I want.
Okay, she agrees.
All right. Let's take off.
Okay, let's go.
So, who would like to roll piloting?
I am with a... Thank God.
18.
I can deal with that.
Okay, so you take off, and you start to fly away from the moon.
I'd suggest that we put ourselves in a high orbit so that we can easily escape it, but I want to just like sit back and make sure that everything's good before we take too long a voyage. Maybe like to sit around for 15 hours or so. Whatever.
I'm just going to take straight off. I'm not wasting any more time dealing with this shit. I just want to make money now. So let's take off. Let's go find a inhabited planet with a society of advanced society. Hopefully more advanced than, you know, zombie gorillas.
Saravok is quite pleased with himself, dreaming of a future of whatever growing space pirate warden slave master dudes do.
Yup.
Okay. So while he's quite happily daydreaming to himself, I'm going to attempt to grapple him and tie him to the chair. Or tie him up in the chair, because he's just in the chair being happy.
Okay. Surprise round grapple and a counter grapple from Saravok, please. And again, I'm using a simplified version where I don't do roll after roll after roll after roll.
So I got a 9. So, and what would my additional be for grapple?
Your additional would be plus 11, and his additional would be plus 8.
Oh my god.
You
slut.
So you basically sneak up behind him and throw a minwire cable around him and start tying him to the chair he's sitting in.
I want to try to tie it around him, not him in the chair.
Oh, right. Okay, you sneak up behind him and you start wrapping the rope around him from behind. And you manage to get the rope wrapped around him.
Okay.
So what would you like to do next?
I would like to do, because I'm assuming that these are like outside systems which can be accessed by colleagues and whatever, turn off the communication system in his suit.
Okay.
Okay. And then start dragging him towards the airlock.
I'm gonna roll to escape.
Yeah, escape artist check, please.
Son of a bitch, are you kidding me? Oh my god. Can this go any worse?
Savruk and Blaster Toad, roll initiative, please.
Son of a bitch.
14.
9.
So, I'm going to do this to make it a little bit quicker, basically because I know what's coming. So, 3 rounds worth of grappling for Savruk. Savruk gets a 20, a 21, and a 13. 3 for Blaster Toad. Blaster Toad gets a 27, 13, and 23. So on the second round, with you just over halfway towards the airlock, Savruk manages basically to wriggle his way out of your dragging arms, but he's still bound up, but he manages to basically wiggle his way away from you.
I grab him again and attempt to tighten the cables, I guess.
Okay, so a grapple check from you to grab him and a grapple check from Savruk to avoid.
23, because of the 11.
Are you shitting me? God damn it.
Savruk gets grabbed and dragged towards the airlock. The airlock pops open as you open the airlock to drag him into the airlock. And sitting inside the airlock are 4 capuchin monkeys with crystals in their chests.
I yell at the monkeys, I thought we had an agreement about this.
I roll to escape or just roll away from him and the monkeys. Are you Are you? How? What? Okay, you know what? If I get a 4 one more time, I'm gonna punch myself in the goddamn balls. This is bullshit.
I throw him in the airlock and then lunge at the controls to open it.
While you are manhandling Savrok in the airlock, the four Capuchin monkeys swarm out into the ship and disappear off down different corridors and into different parts of the ship.
Are you fucking serious?
The ship's internal comm array, which is permanently active because it's a small interplanetary ship, so it receives and sends messages all the time, sparks to life, and you hear a voice that you don't recognize. The reason you don't recognize is this voice is a chocolate-warm female voice, the sort of voice that you'd expect from a late-night female newsreader. The voice conjures into your mind the idea of beautiful people and intelligent people. And it simply explains that it would like to thank you for the help, but unfortunately, further deals and trade agreements will have to be suspended. The long-range transmission system you have provided with it is all it really needs to gather materials. It's quite happy with how you worked. You did extremely well for a lesser organism with lower intelligence. You are welcome to, of course, become part of Mother if you wish, but unfortunately, if you don't wish, then your further existence would be a risk to Mother, and perhaps you should land in that nice little glowing bit of crater down on the planet.
So it's basically saying, if you don't join me, I'm gonna crash you in space crack.
Yep.
I'm gonna roll to escape, and I'll just do that first. See if I can. Are you shitting me? Are you shitting me? Are you absolutely serious right now? Oh my god, what is this?
Okay,
AIDS?
So I've got 5 health.
I can't say anything because you turned my comm off, so I'm just sitting there shaking to myself like a little dumbass. You absolute cock, Mumford. How could you do this to me?
Because you were going to make a deal with, like, crazy super intelligent computer.
Says the person who made a deal with the crazy super intelligent computer.
But left bombs to blow it up unknowingly.
Says the person who turned the computer on and gave it access to everything in the first place, you shit.
Just remember, I was wise enough not to give it eyes.
Savrok and Jake, before we continue, I would like to point out that Savrok said he sat in the pilot's chair and opened his mask. You are an oxygenated environment. I assume Blastotope closed his mask and turned off his microphone, but
that was what I was imagining.
It's a spaceship mask. If you were to sort of be shouting and screaming, it wouldn't be completely silent.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be completely sort of free.
Yeah.
So feel all free to, you know, scream abuse at Blastotope.
I'm a screamer. Yeah, untie me. Untie me, you son of a bitch. You're now we're definitely dead. There's 4 zombie monkeys on the ship.
Who knows doing God knows what? Untie me now so we can fix this.
Because clearly, if it's going to renege on the deal, then I am down for whatever the hell we can do to make it pay. So, untie me.
Okay, whatever I have in the airlock, I want to jam open on the ship's jam open the ship side airlock doors.
Okay.
Okay. And then I tie both myself and Saravok to one of the spacesuit lockers.
Okay.
Are you going to tie me?
I'm going to close his helmet, as mine's also closed, and I'm going to open the outside door. Override and open the outside door. Try to flush those little bastards into space with an explosive decompression. I know the decompression itself won't kill them, but I can at least try to vacuum them out.
So you're gonna kill us? I hate you.
Okay, four little space monkeys that can hide freaking anywhere, or you know, maybe not. But
has decompressing anything not almost killed one of us yet? Ah, you shit. You shit.
So, what happens, Mr. DM? Almighty controller of world?
That's what I'm figuring out with these dice.
You sound like you're having a hard time with this.
That's because this is... I know the basic principles of these rules for getting this to work, but like... Okay,
nobody's broken a game like us.
No, nobody's been quite as mad when I've DM'd them. Okay, so you tie yourselves to a locker and close up your masks and you open the exterior door and there is a huge pressure of the wind blowing out of the ship. Not being sucked out, bear in mind, blowing out of the ship, because that's the way it works.
Mm-hmm.
And three little capuchin monkeys go flying past you. Roll a reflex save for me, both of you.
How can he reflex? He's in a, like, bondage wrap.
Yeah, oh, I'm tied come to on. Multiple... Oh my god, are you shitting me?
So I got a 5, 6, 7.
I got 7 as well.
Blastotoad, take 1 damage, and Sarabuk, take 3 damage for me.
Okay.
As monkeys go sailing past, a huge assortment of other things come sailing past with them.
Mm-hmm.
Several things smack you on the way past.
Well, especially since we like had the monkeys guys load this ship full of like all the other crap we found.
Quite a lot of things go sailing past you. 3 of 4 monkeys disappear out the airlock. There is still a monkey somewhere on the ship.
Okay. I close the outside door.
Yep.
Alright.
I untie us.
I push
this guy against a airlock or a spacesuit rack. Say, if you criminal fucking creep cut off any more hands, blow off any more heads, or try to greedily wiggle yourself into bed with any more super evil whatever the hell's intelligences, you are getting spaced. Now let's go monkey hunting.
All right, let's do it then. Fine.
Okay, so how are you going to...
You actually untied me now?
You're untied now.
Okay, good. Asshole.
How are you going to set about your monkey hunting?
I'm going to draw my pistol and start monkey hunting.
I'm going to equip my shotgun and I'm just going to kill him. I'm done with his bullshit. He's tried to kill me too many times now. I'm going to shoot him in the back.
What?
That's enough of your shit. You've attempted to kill me too many times. I'm just straight up shooting you. We're not getting off this thing alive. I'm taking it down with us. I'm killing you, and then I'm just gonna take the ship back. That's it. You absolute cock.
Okay.
You've attempted to kill me 3 times now. You've tied me up twice.
I've only attempted to kill you once.
Okay, you attempted to kill me once, but you've almost killed me 3 times. There you go. Not to mention you unleashed this entire thing to begin with. It's only fair.
Remember, I got higher armor class now. Be nice to me. Come on, droid. What happened?
17 plus 7, 24. He does hit you, I'm afraid.
With 3d6? God damn it.
Okay, there's 2. I don't know why the third one wasn't selecting.
Fucking hell. PvP in this game has just been insta-killed. Okay, so he puts a shotgun round through the back of your skull, Toad. That doesn't massively matter because, while he puts a shotgun round in the back of your skull, little Mr. Capuchin pulls out the thing that has been blocking the interior door and the interior airlock door swishes closed. and locks him in the airlock.
I was gonna crash the ship. No.
Yes. Yes. He gets airlocked after all. Eat a dick.
Son of a bitch.
See, I was gonna ask you guys how you were gonna go about monkey hunting, and then I was gonna ask you guys to roll spot and to see if you spotted the capuchin monkey, like sitting just around the corner. But like, no, no, you just decide to fight each other instead.
No.
So
no.
Your space shuttle. Spirals down into the crack in the planet. Just after your space shuttle smashes into the crack in the planet and insta-kills Savruk, the moon experiences a whomp, and the moon splits in half, and pieces of crystal go flying out into space. Unfortunately, it's been several hours since you left the planet, and the massive intelligence of the planet and Ara have together created a program that has been sent out by the long-range transmission. Mm-hmm. And essentially, you have spread the crystalline intelligence out, and it is currently sort of floating off in multiple different directions. And you have allowed it the opportunity to send out a essentially AI program out into the universe. So,
see, if it was like just crazy AI I had to deal with, I was like, okay, I'm totally ready for that. But now we also have pieces of crystal that may happen to land on planets. Actually, if it's going through an atmosphere, it should burn off all of the Mother's Companion.
Doesn't matter, we're both dead.
Re-entering atmosphere.
So, that was the end of the campaign.
That was epic.
That was amazing.
Like, if you gotta end it big.
Yeah, I'm glad it went down that way.
I'm glad you got space locked. I'm so glad you got space locked.
I'm so glad I finally blew your head off. You deserved it.
Airlock.
I'm so glad I killed you. Honestly, I was waiting since, like, day one to just kill your ass. You did nothing but almost get us killed the entire way. Every idea only brought more harm.
We would have made it off, and I would have had my own spaceship, except for you and your bloody shotgun. And Ira being a backstabbing bitch.
See, if we would have just done it my way, we would have, you know, not possibly died. But no.
Okay, Ira had no need for us. She was gonna get rid of us one way or the other. There's a reason why there's monkeys in the airlock.
I don't know.
That's the name of this episode.
As I said time and time again, and I've said to you guys outside of the recordings time and time again, there have been, if I just do a sort of like estimate, I haven't counted them up, but at a rough estimate, there have been 14 opportunities for you to escape this alive.
We're going to have to go over those through the Q&A, yeah.
As an estimate, there have been 14 opportunities. You have missed huge amounts of story. And the story has taken all sorts of twists and turns that, as DM, I didn't necessarily expect because of both the rolls of the dice and the choices you've made. And this has ended in a very classic Penny Dreadful event, a very classic Penny Dreadful event of you guys basically plummeting to your doom and unavoidably being destroyed. There were ways for you to escape and to have a happy ending, but they just didn't come true. I hope you guys enjoyed the campaign. I hope you guys loved what happened. I found it absolutely hilarious. There were whole hour and a half sections where I just sat here and listened to you two argue with each other. You're both brand new to tabletop RPG, and the way you've handled your characters and the way you've handled the RPG has been absolutely wonderful. The fact that I've managed to psychologically scar Toad in real life has been...
That's just icing on the cake for you, eh?
It's just a blessing. It's just like, yes. So, I have nothing else to say. Like, thank you for playing. Thank you for taking what I thought would be a 4-hour campaign and turning it into a 20-something hour extravaganza.
It's been interesting.
It's been a shit show, and I've loved every minute.
I'm very, very pleased with the beginning and the end. Everything that kind of happened in the middle, I'm going to try to suppress. But... you know, it's been good.
Yeah. It's been fantastic. I'm so glad I finally killed you, though. Shit.
Yeah.
Okie dokie. So, guys, with the session ended and with the campaign over, in this session, you've found multiple bodies. You've discovered a warning note from the head researcher on the station, and it completely ignored it. And you have been backstabbed time and time again. The number of backstabs you have received, you don't even know. You've backstabbed each other. Both of you.
No, he backshot me.
Yeah, and, yeah, and you back tied him up and almost back airlocked him. So
kind of had it coming to you.
So you guys have your characters, the two people who found themselves in this situation have mental breakdowns and turned into monsters. And the best way to deal with the monster is exactly what happened. You've been destroyed. The campaign is finished, but the world now has to live with what you've done. You have,
and I so hope we get to explore this world.
You have released a dangerous artificial intelligence virus. You have released a crystalline intelligence and a self-replicating intelligent life form. Although you've broken it into pieces, it is now sailing off into the distance in multiple directions. You have done incalculable damage to the future of mankind. And your reward is death. You deserved worse. But for now, death will suffice. Thank you very much for playing, guys.
Oh, thanks so much for having us, Droid. And again, without you, this whole shenanigan would not have been possible. So thanks again for being our dungeon master and putting the time and effort into building this world for us. It has been a pleasure to destroy.
Yeah, that's it. It's just, it was amazing. Thank you. That was fantastic on every level.
Thank you very much for playing, guys. It has been delightful.